You know, if you design studies appropriately, what you do is you design them to prove you wrong. So that's what's called the null hypothesis. So basically, I designed the study to prove that what my suspicions were not correct. So we designed it so that we would find any possibility of stress in these horses' lives. And we didn't find any. With clipping, just turning the clippers on and walking up to a horse and just shaving a little patch, they get about a 6-degree change in temperature of the medial campus, okay? And you can see in our study, we got no change again. So it means they didn't care. This is the most no change study I've ever been so excited about, okay, because there's no change. And this shows you the temperature of the horses at the park. Pretty neat, huh? What we did is we went to the Clinton, we talked to Connor. He said, you guys do whatever you need to do. And I thought the best thing that he said to me was, and then if we find anything wrong, maybe we can find a way to fix it, which to me was really important for me to hear that. So he had nothing to do with anything concerning with how the study was completed. We also walked in and he said, so what do you want to do? And I said, we need to pick horses. And he didn't say, well, these are excluded, this one you can't use, that one you can't use. Basically, every horse in the stable was open to us. And we just randomly said, let's just choose all the horses on the second floor because we don't want to be running up and down stairs all day. So, but there was no limitation as to which horses we used. We just wanted ones that were working. So what we did was we used infrared thermography. And then we use salivary cortisol levels. So we use this little sponge, it's a child sponge, that they actually soak their saliva in and measure cortisol. If you're a horse and I go like this, my cortisol levels are gonna go up. And so cortisol levels in horses tend to be whoop, 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 like all over the place. And this is kind of a smoothing. The salivary cortisol is very smoothing to the data. So you can say a lot more about the salivary cortisol than any point of blood cortisol. And then we did fecal cortisol because that's a measure of more chronic stress. That's what an image looks like, and this is one that's been analyzed. And what you do is you draw this circle, and this finds the hottest point and the coldest point and the mean. So the hottest point is always going to be the medial campus, so you can see that that's what's marked right here. So this is the medial campus right there. So if I were to stress you out and take a picture of your medial campus, I would see the temperature change. And then we did four time points, and the time points were designed to accommodate the work schedule and to find the points where we thought that something, we wanted a really good baseline, and then we wanted to find the points where something might happen. And so we did it during the day shift. So the first time point was about an hour before any of the drivers came to the stable. And they hadn't actually done a lot, so the horses were really calm. So we thought that this was a good point. Horses were at rest in their stalls. Most of them did this, just so that you guys know this. I also do work on sleep in horses, and I've written several papers on sleep. And one thing that you'll know that a horse is really comfortable with their environment is if they will lie down to sleep. And what happened was, almost invariably, when we came in the morning, at least half the barn were lying down in their stalls. And they don't do that because they're tired. They do that because they can actually feel comfortable in their environment, and they can collect the REM sleep that they need. And I actually did see a few REMing. So that's pretty cool. So this is the time that we collected the feces. And then the next point, and salivary cortisol and the IRT. The next time we did it is when the horses were hitched. So right here we would do the IRT, the infrared, and we would also do the salivary cortisol at some point in this first harnessing. And then time point three, horses are returned to the stall. So right as they came in, we collected the next one because we figured if this experience in the city were a bad one, their cortisols would be really high. And so that's when we collected those. Again, saliva and the IRT. Sarah went out and she collected feces from horses that were on furlough out in Pennsylvania, okay? And we said, okay, for interest's sake, let's see what the furlough horses look like too. This diagram shows this is the horses in the stable, okay? And this is the horses that were out in pasture, all right? So now what this shows is, these were not different from each other, the mean But you can see there's huge variation in the horses that are out in pasture versus the ones that are in the stable. I mean, this data is so tight, it was incredible to see this. So that just shows that horses that are out in pasture, some of them, at least at the moment that we collected the feces, had some type of stress in their life, okay? Whereas these horses didn't do much. And then if you look at the numbers, 150, 1.6 to 36, 35, the controls in those studies are all either above or at this, which means that these horses had no stress. So then if we look at our salivary cortisols at all four of the time points, like in the sham study, this is just clipping. This is just taking a set of clippers and clipping a horse to see. So that shows you how low stress that was, right? Because most horses don't mind. And you can see here that that about doubled it, okay? That doubled the cortisol. This is with transport. That went up multiple folds. And this is show jumping. This is as the horses are saddled and they're put through a show jumping event. But the main thing to notice, if you look at this values and this, that these horses at the four time points did not move in salivary cortisol. There was no difference. Which means basically what they were like in the morning, which was very low stress, they were like when they got harnessed, they were like probably this little bit of an increase might be due to them knowing that they're going to go out for a jog, which is normal. That should happen. But you can see it didn't go off the wall like these. I mean, these numbers here, 0.45 are up here. Then it just happened this worked out. We went to the park and collected a group of, just randomly sample. I think, did we collect? I think we did. We collected your horse. Mm-hmm. The one you were driving.
Yep, and Tyson.
Yeah, Tyson. We collected Tyson. And we went out to the park and just collected, we were at the park and just collected a bunch and did some IRTs. And you can see that even at the park, and this doesn't work in the statistics, so we have to show this separate. Even at the park, that's what they were standing in front of the park. Which I don't want to say this, but it almost sounds like they were more relaxed at the park. They just loved it, or at least equivalent to being in their stall in the morning, okay? And so we found no evidence of physiologic stress in the New York carriage horses as measured by our analysis. Now, the important thing about our study is that you can see a horse that doesn't look very stressful, but he is stressed. So our study simply puts forth the conclusion that other experts who visited the stables have seen, that the horses look great. So this is Sarah Ralston, she's at Rutgers. I wish all horses could be cared for at this level. This is not a humane issue. This is Harry Werner, who's a good friend of mine, and he's past president of the AEP, and this is a CBS News thing. The attitudes and behavior of horses were those that we associate with a contented horse. They were interested in their environments, would put their heads out to be stroked, and had their ears forward. And Harry's only, I think he's only worked on horses for 50 years. It's not just my observation, because if I see a horse getting abused, I'm going to be the first one to jump in there and do something about it. And, and against my work with the Unwanted Horse Coalition and with the Equitarian Group proves that I will jump in if I see abuse. And again, I can say that because the experts that I know, every one of them that have visited, especially Jack Lowe, who was a New York State Extension veterinarian, and Harry Werner and Steve O'Grady and other people that have visited, they come in and they go, I wish my clients would treat their horses as well. And several of them have said to me, they'd be out of work if this were their clients.